if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say this was their finest hour.
We stand for Queen, Country, and Video Games. BRB UK. Worse teeth, better accents.
Hello and welcome to episode 233 of the Big Red Barrel UK podcast. I am Coleman. Hi! And Dan seems to have forgotten he was taking 2 weeks off and has extended that into 3 weeks.
2 weeks!
We've genuinely lost Dan. We don't know what happened. We hope he's back next week. Anyway, in the absence of a Dan, we also have a Tim.
Hello!
Hello, Tim.
Hello!
How are you enjoying things?
Pretty well. We're well in the silly season of video games. There's a new console out tomorrow, and amazing games all around us. It's a good time to be a video gamer.
And a man who is furiously ripping his hair out while refreshing his Amazon order page, waiting for that dispatch notification of his new and shiny handheld / home console, the Nintendo Switch. It's Mr. Colin Farrell. No, it's Diarmuid.
Hello there.
Hello there.
And yeah, I really don't have any hair left. It's all over the floor. What's going on here? My goodness. It's been stuck on dispatching now for all day. Like, at work, I had it on a tab and was just refreshing every so often going, come
That's
on.
That's along now.
Come on.
I had this with Pokemon Sun and Moon. So I ordered those as a surprise and I was expecting them day one.
Did you say you ordered them as a surprise?
I ordered them as a surprise for Lauren.
Right, okay, because I was going to say, you can't surprise yourself if you've ordered them for yourself.
Well, I ordered them from Toys R Us, so it's a gamble whether they turn up or
right,
not.
Right, okay.
If you have short-term memory loss, that could help.
There's that too, yeah. So I think it was the day before, they still had warehouse order processing or something, and I was getting really annoyed because it hadn't confirmed, and there's meant to be these different steps before they actually dispatch it. So the day I sent an email to go cancel the order and then went out and bought the games, and then I came back and then I got an email at 1 minute to midnight saying dispatched. So yeah, it happens sometimes. I've never heard of Amazon doing it though, so I don't think you're getting
I'm looking at the page right now. It now says shipping today but arriving on Saturday.
Oh, that's not good. It's like, 'cause I happen to know you have cinema tickets booked for Saturday.
Yes.
Do you want
to
wait in and get your Switch for you?
Yeah, you come over and just hang in the house, house it for a while.
Then I can play Horizon.
Exactly.
Cool, I like this arrangement.
This sounds like the opening of a sitcom setup, basically.
I thought Diarmuid lived in a sitcom already. Anyway, okay, so we've got news, we've got to cover it, and I'm going to start off with the headline that I have been super excited about this week, Middle Earth.
Right.
Shadow of War announced.
Right.
The sequel to Shadow of Mordor. My favourite game of 2014. One of the rare games that I gave a perfect score.
I couldn't help but be slightly underwhelmed by this news. I liked the first one. I thought it had some really interesting mechanical systems. I didn't play that deep into it. And so maybe that plays into some of the reasons why the trailer didn't hit that hard with me, basically. But I don't know, I just felt the title was a little underwhelming.
The title is terrible, and I'll admit that. Shadow of War.
Yeah, and the game itself looked like a lot more of the same, and I was hoping for, I don't know, something, taking it from a different angle. Even perhaps applying this formula to a completely different universe I might have been more interested in, type thing. Like, imagine this in the Batman universe or, you know, another Warner Brothers property type thing.
Well, that was the thing. I remember hearing a rumor around PlayStation Experience time that Warner Brothers were going to announce a Batman game where Batman was Damian Wayne rather than Bruce. And it was going to introduce the Nemesis system.
That rumor's still running deep.
Yeah, I know. It's one of those things where, that has been around for so long that it has to be true at this stage. It has to
no
be.
No smoke without fire, you're hoping on that one.
Exactly. But, that's, I like that idea. But as for this news in particular, like, I'm excited about it, but the way it happened was just a bit...
On Sunday night, Target accidentally leaked their lineup overzealously. And so the next day, I don't know if it was intended for Warner Brothers to announce it the next day, or they just went, all hands on deck, right, release it, everyone know, trailer, cool, press release, let's go, let's do this. But I got super excited about it. I absolutely loved the previous game. I played it to completion, went through all the DLC, and that was one of those weird games. Like, I loved the game so much that I went back and bought the season pass so I could play all the DLC and stuff as well, which I don't usually do.
But yeah, I mean, look, I'm definitely happy that you're happy, if you see what I mean. Like, I'm
very happy.
Yeah, I'm not wanting to on your chips and kind of, you know, put a downer on anyone that is looking forward to
the game. Why would you do that?
There are a lot of people...
It's disgusting.
Yeah, there are a lot of people that are quite excited by it, and I'm all happy for them. I'm just, as I said, some of those things didn't hit with me. Again, like you said, you played it to completion. It did say, like, none of the things will be forgotten. And I'm like, well, I don't remember them, so...
What I liked especially about that game is for a period, it seemed like the world was playing this game, especially on my Twitter feed and Facebook feed. Because if someone in your friend list was killed by an orc, then... Well, they weren't called orcs, though. They were called something else, but I can't remember what
Uruk-hai?
It was.
Uruk-hai? No.
Say like, Tim... No, they weren't Uruk-hai. They're somewhere in between Uruk-hai and orcs.
Okay.
But say, like, Dan gets murdered in the game... And then it goes, hey, you go avenge Captain Average now because this orc killed him. And then you have to go out and avenge him.
Yeah, yeah.
I liked that mode for some reason. But it then led to my Twitter and my Facebook feeds being blown up with screenshots of, I avenged you, Kev. You know. I quite liked that for a moment. But then it stopped really quickly. That got old after a day.
Yeah, I think based on the... tweets from Warner Bros. Games beforehand, they seem to be teeing this the actual announcement up for PAX, which I think is next weekend.
Okay.
I think around the 8th of March, and I think that's when they were actually going to tee this up, but I think now they're doing gameplay then, so I do think they kind of dropped this early, but they obviously had the trailer in the bag and just said, well, it's out now, may as well just, you know, release it.
Don't you think that they might as well have just waited for PAX in that situation, wouldn't you? I mean, just like, so what if there's a rumor out there? That'll get less coverage than the actual announcement, so...
Well, that's the thing. It wasn't so much a rumor. There was key art.
Right,
there was
okay.
Logo.
So...
You know, it was a bit... It was a bit too much. It was pretty much the entire game just, there it is. And it's like everyone was... No one questioned it. No one thought, okay, this may be happening. No, this was happening.
Okay.
So they kind of did have to... This was their 15 minutes, so they kind of had to get out there, you know? But still, I mean, I'm looking forward to the gameplay. I want to see what they have changed, because apparently, while the Nemesis system is back, they're making changes to it and they're expanding it and things like that, and that could be really, really cool.
So now when you set bees on an orc, then the bees will remember you and come back for revenge. Looking forward to that. Interactive bees with an Nemesis system. So this is going to come out on the 22nd of August in North America, 25th of August in Europe and UK, and Australia not yet confirmed as this time of recording.
That's actually a very good time as well. That's probably going to be around a drought time. And that's the perfect time that you want a kind of an open world expansive game like that, because you can really kind of dedicate some time to it.
Yeah, it's late drought period, isn't it? Late August is kind of, you know, just as things are beginning to pick up in September, October sort of time. But
yeah,
probably a sensible time, as you say.
That's going to come out on PS4, Xbox One, including Project Scorpio, Steam, and Windows 10. So there you go. Oh, and it will be an Xbox Play Anywhere title. Anyway, talking about Play Anywhere, Microsoft have revealed the Xbox Game Pass during GDC this week. You know, PlayStation Now that Sony started doing, and everyone got excited about it, and then everyone started dropping off of it when they actually revealed more information going forward, and now they've started removing it from platforms.
Yep.
Yes.
This is like that, but instead of streaming, you have access to just download titles from the store.
That takes away one of the only advantages of PlayStation Now, but anyway.
It does, but that means there's no issue with you know, having to have a strong internet connection.
It takes away a lot of the problems as well, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of data caps, and well, although downloading Xbox One games especially are still quite costly in data caps.
Yeah, that doesn't help with that situation, but it does help with the, you know, lag and you know, other problems with syncing and all that type of stuff.
Yes, but the more interesting thing about it, it's been priced at £7.99 a month, which is just a little bit more than Netflix.
Yeah.
And that's a price point I'm happy with.
Yeah, that's a good price point, basically. It's another kind of a sensible move that is, okay, very reactionary to what PlayStation is doing or has done, but is another very sensible move on their behalf, doing things at a better price point. Maybe, you know, it remains to be seen exactly what games will be covering it, but they seem to be saying the right things about that as well so far.
Well, the partners signed up for this are 2K, 505 Games, Bandai Namco Entertainment, Capcom, Codemasters, Deep Silver, Focus Home Interactive, Sega, SNK Corporation, THQ Nordic, and Warner Brothers.
No word on EA then.
No word on EA. Funnily enough, they've got their own system.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
At the moment, they showed a quick kind of collage of games spread across, and some of them a bit hard to make out. But the specific games that have been titled at the moment are Halo 5, Guardians, Payday 2, NBA 2K16, Soul Calibur 2. I think I saw Tekken Tag Tournament in there as well.
I actually think this is going to work a little bit like what the Switch subscription service, when it eventually comes out, the online subscription service, the way that's going to work in terms of the games you get. So yeah, there's going to be your library of about 100 games, and as games come in, games will be rotated out.
So just Netflix then?
Well, yeah, exactly. But the difference here is, if a game comes out, and but you want to kind of keep it, you've given it a trial, you've played it for a month or two, or a month, or however long the 100 titles are in there, blah, 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 but you want to keep it, you'll actually be able to buy the game after that at a cheaper price. So that's kind of cool. So I think it's a really good program. I'm hoping it gets supported quite a lot. I hope it's not a handful of Xbox One games and the rest of them are all Xbox 360 backwards compatible games, although that's not entirely a bad thing either, but you know what I mean.
One of the biggest problems when they announced PlayStation Now was they went, okay, we've got 100 titles available, and it was like every iteration of Ben 10. Like, I don't care about any of this.
Yeah, I think that was mostly down to the fact that external publishers just did not buy into it, and obviously the audience didn't either.
No, not even that. Dan read through every single game on. He was like, "Right, name a game." We're like, "Well, let's go for this game." No, it's not on there. This game, no, it's not on there. All right, well, all right, we're thinking wrong. We need PlayStation specific, PlayStation exclusive. What about Uncharted? No Uncharted at launch. Okay, what about Little Big Planet? No Little Big Planet at launch. And it just carried on like that. It was just a really muddled, weird mix of games to be announced at launch.
I think it was mostly first party as well. Like, Sony basically put like all the Uncharted and all that kind of stuff up there. And after that, it just sort of stagnated. There hasn't been really any new announcements with it either. So I'd say that's going to be shelved fairly soon.
To be fair, I haven't kept that close an eye on it. But I mean, it's one of those things where, look, as I said, this seems like a well thought out scheme. It does remain to be seen how well it is supported with games, but it's a hard thing because you have to support it for quite a long time to get that mass of people that makes it attractive to other people to put games on your service, basically. It might be a difficult uphill struggle, but yeah, like you say, hopefully something that we see well supported and yeah, become good.
At that price, and if the selection's decent enough, then I see myself using this, and I could actually see myself switching. I mean, if enough people did the same as me, I'd probably switch to Xbox One as my main console in consequence of this program, if it's good enough. And to cap that off, so the Xbox Game Pass, it's already in beta for select members of the Xbox Insider Preview Program Alpha Ring. So people that were on the preview program, well, certain people that were on the preview program before they made the preview program available to everyone.
Alpha Ring sounds like the area of a space station reserved for elitists.
It is.
Basically.
It is. I remember that from Starship Troopers.
Yeah.
Cool. Xbox Live Gold members will also receive access to the Xbox Game Pass ahead of it launching to non-Gold users. Yeah, all exciting. I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, that's quite cool.
I'm looking forward to how that goes. I'm not happy with Xbox at the moment, so I need them to curry my favour a little bit. Xbox has not been notifying me of my messages, which means I was in the beta for Gwent.
Right.
And I didn't know this until a month late.
Oh, good.
So thanks, Xbox. I missed the beta.
That's not very good.
Okay, those are the two headlines. So we're going to jump through the updates real quick. Also from GDC and also from Xbox, there's been the announcement of the Xbox Live Creators Program.
Mm-hmm.
Now you can easily make games if you are a indie developer and you wish to publish your games to Xbox One and Windows 10 PC, and also in future Project Scorpio as well. This is a much quicker way of doing it. There is a whole write-up on the Xbox, what do they call it? The Xbox Wire? Live Wire? I forget what they call their blog.
I forget what it is, but yeah, sounds right.
Yeah, it's on there.
Good.
Interested me mostly because it wasn't that long ago, Tim, where you said they should bring back the...
Xbox Live Indie Arcade thing, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Indie Arcade. And that's essentially this.
Well, no. In fact, when we were talking about that, I said they should bring out an expanded version of that. But subject to our recent talk about how much of a, for want of a better word, shit show Steam Greenlight was, do you think this is necessarily a good idea? I mean, in an altruistic, you know, in a kind of nice kind of, this is a... you know, makes it open for everyone thing. Are we sure we want things like this to be open to everyone? Doesn't that lead to a lower quality of game in some
way? I mean, it depends. Is it going to be a separate... is it going to have its own section, or is this just going to appear all over the marketplace?
Yeah, that's it's how they integrate it within the marketplace that is... For me, they need a clearer delineation between the type of things that should be coming under this type thing and the type of thing that's a, for want of a better phrase, full Xbox Live type, you know, title type thing. Or, you know, what's a better word than that? A full downloadable game in the sense that we you know, kind of cover it today. It's weird, like, there's no proper word or phrase that we actually use that covers these games properly. Downloadable games is, you know, more often than not kind of accurate, but that's a conversation for another time. But generally speaking, yeah, it's I don't know, I'm not entirely certain that this is necessarily a good thing unless it's well handled, basically, or well governed is probably the better term. But yeah,
we'll see as that comes to fruition, I guess. It's a pity we haven't got Dan this week, actually, because I wanted to get his opinion on this one. Randy Pitchford took to the stage at the Game Developers Conference this week to show off a bit of Borderlands 3, more specifically like a tech demo of Borderlands 3 showing the Unreal Engine 4 in action.
Right.
I'm not a Borderlands fan, and I know Dan is. I don't know about you guys. I appreciate Borderlands, but I can't really get excited about it. I showed it to Lauren and she hit the roof.
Yeah, I'm certainly not a Borderlands fan in the same way that your other half is, but I like Borderlands and I always was attracted to the art style. Like, the Switch and the original art style of the first Borderlands was something that attracted to me pre-release type thing. That's when I kind of picked up on it. But I've never played the series as deeply as it possibly deserves. I think that's probably the best way to put it.
I've tried a couple of times, I just can't get into it.
Yeah.
Anyway, I looked at it. He showed a kind of sphere and showed some all these different effects happening to the sphere. And then he did a quick tour through Pandora in the Unreal Engine 4. And none of the stuff shown is necessarily going to be in the game. It actually looked like they took assets from 2. And
just kind of up-res them a bit, sort of thing.
Yeah, just to show you what it could do with the old assets. I'm guessing that's what they were doing.
The other thing that possibly makes me slightly less excited about this, again, not wanting to on anyone's chips that's particularly excited about this.
You've got to find a different phrase. Yeah, I don't have to beep.
But anyway, what do you have against chips? But yeah, up until you kind of talked about that news article, I could have sworn that they'd already made Borderlands 3. That was part of the problem. I was like,
no, they made the pre-sequel.
Yeah, I forgot that was the thing, kind of. I knew they made another one. I was like, oh yeah, it was a prequel. Like, but it took me a while after hearing Borderlands 3 to realise that.
All right.
Yeah.
Dear Med, you're getting a Switch.
He's getting Switch.
Are you going to go get one of those there Pro controllers with the Switch?
I actually am, and the sad news is the Pro controller is probably going to arrive before my Switch. But anyway,
sit there at just least sadly according the joysticks.
Well, no, according to this next news story, it may not be all downhill. I do have a PC, and what do you know, it happens to support it. That's kind of cool.
Yes, so if you get the Pro controller, it turns out that it's completely compatible with the PC day one. That's using the Bluetooth feature, not connecting via USB-C cable.
Right.
And you can't charge the controller with the cable, but you can't while you're using the Bluetooth connection. So basically any kind of cable connection just severs you being able to use it as a controller to the PC.
So that's something they might patch to work a bit more properly than that at some point, though.
I'm assuming so. It's a feature. The interesting thing is Nintendo never mentioned that this is going to be a feature that you could use the controller with the PC.
Do you think they didn't know?
Maybe.
Possible.
What? You can what?
I mean, yeah, totally. We definitely planned that.
What is this thing you call a PC?
Yeah, hang on. What's a PC?
I do like that idea. But the Pro Controller, hasn't it got a ridiculous amount of battery life to it?
Yeah, it's huge. I think it's something like, is it, what, 80 hours?
Nice.
Is that a number I'm pulling out of my backside? It could be.
I remember the Pro Controller on the Wii U was very similar. I mean, just for reference, I dug up my Wii U not too long ago, wiped all the dust off of it. The tablet was completely out of battery, but the Pro Controller was still full. I was like, wow, that's impressive.
Well, you could probably use the Pro Controller to go through, what, 30 different Switches battery lives or something?
Probably.
Exactly. Before the actually, I've just found the figure. It's actually closer to 40 hours.
Okay, well, that's still a lot of hours.
But that's still a lot of hours.
It's still like 15 Switches.
Considering I go through like two PS4 controllers a day, that's a lot of hours. Also in Nintendo news lastly this week, so during the reveal of the Nintendo Switch at the event, they kind of went for a sizzle reel of all these different games, and one of them wasn't named, and people wanted to know what it was.
Right.
It's called Project Mekaru.
Mekaru!
I think it's just called Mekaru now, which means... It's Japanese for flipping.
Mekaruel, mate.
It's a Unity puzzle game made exclusive for Switch. There's no release date yet, but it's been shown off this week by a company called Over Fence and has a four-player battle mode.
I don't know about you, but I have had kind of an affinity for a Nintendo launch game puzzle launch game thing before in the past. It's been known.
Yeah, I like couch co-op puzzle games as well. Couch battle, I guess, is an appropriate word.
Battle your couch.
Like, four-player local Tetris is my idea. Decent. That is a party that's going on all night long.
Well, lucky for you, Puyo Puyo Tetris. You can Tetris while you Puyo Puyo, and Puyo is Puyo while you Tetris. I believe it is, actually.
Local?
I think so.
Wow, we're going to be partying until the break of dawn at Diarmuid's.
Oh, yeah.
If we're done on the Mekaru-ness, that's one question I have for you, Diarmuid.
Yes.
The first one is obvious. So my question for you is, what is the second game you are going to buy for your Switch?
I already have this in mind, and it was when they announced what the eShop games were going to be on the store. And as you can imagine, there aren't that many.
Yep.
But one of them is called Fast MRX.
And Furious.
It's basically, it's the F-Zero clone that they had on the Wii U.
Fast and something Neo or something?
Something like that,
It's such a generic, forgettable name, unfortunately, but it looks
exactly
good.
Exactly.
Like, is it Fast Action Nero?
No.
Neo?
No.
Nero.
Fast Action Nero? No. You're getting an Arnold Schwarzenegger film confused with a chain of coffee shops.
Apparently it's called Fast RMX.
No, it's Fast Racing Neo.
I think Diarmuid knows Fast the game that he wants
okay.
to buy better
no,
than
the
you
one
got.
I'm thinking
no, no.
Of,
the, okay.
The, one I'm
the original. The original on the Wii U was Fast Racing Neo.
God,
the one
it, that's
on the
what
Switch.
I was talking about.
The one on the Switch is Fast RMX, which
okay.
is a sequel
right.
to it. But that's coming out in launch as well.
That's not the game I thought you meant, but okay.
Well, I'm going to go pick up Fast Racing Neo to stuff you. Now I'm playing my Wii U again. And I'm going to have fun with it.
And no one's going to stop
yeah.
me.
No. I'm going to play my four-player couch battle mode.
But yeah,
no one there.
Literally, from the launch lineup, as a someone that's not a massive fan of Zelda like myself, I would probably pick that game up because it's looking like it's getting great reviews and it's probably a good time to retry the series again. But most of the other things that I would be wanting to pick up day one if I was in your position of having pre-ordered one... Like, are things
yes.
that aren't available at launch. Like, and some of them are available quite soon after launch, like Street Fighter, Ultra Street Fighter 2 and stuff like that. But, yeah, most of the stuff isn't there for me. I don't know.
Yeah, I think the Switch is basically going to be my Zelda console for, like, the first month or so. And then kind of other games will start trickling in. But, like, during that... Nindy showcase that they had, there was actually some games in there that I thought were quite cool, and I like the look of SteamWorld Dig 2 looks really good, Runner 3 looks good. When they come out, I don't know. I'm hoping it's fairly soon, because that should be fairly quick to get onto the Switch, but we'll have to wait
and
see.
You don't know how you know feature complete those games are at the moment, type thing.
Exactly.
I think it could be a case of, you know, they were just showing off as many games as they could because it helps plug the gap in their market. And you know, it's a good lesson to have learned from how PlayStation handled their launch lineup and stuff like that, basically, for the PS4. And, you know, indie games were well represented and plugged a nice gap for them, basically. And I can see that doing Nintendo at least trying to make, you know, similar kind of motions, at least.
Yeah, and indie titles plug gaps throughout the life cycle as well. I mean, there's still some decent ones coming out on the PS4, and the exclusives are sort of placed throughout the year, and then in between them you have those smaller titles that find their audience.
For me, it's going to be interesting just seeing what games are more exclusive for the console. And it's not necessarily even that it has to be a completely exclusive title, but just maybe, like, you know, in the last generation we saw like Batman remade for Wii U, and that was a bit haphazard, and that's possibly a bad example. But I think it'd be more interesting to see games on the console that are taking advantage of that console's best attributes type thing.
For instance, one of the games, it's not so much a like a feature on the console, but it's kind of the main thing on the console, really. But one of the things I was really tempted to actually double dip on, I Am Setsuna.
Right, okay, I still haven't played that. Is it good?
It's very good. If you like kind of old school JRPGs, it is very good. And I've played it on PS4 and I've gotten very close to the end. But I kind of left it alone because something else came along at the time. I can't remember what it was, and I just haven't jumped back into it. But the feature of being able to take the Switch on the go
suits that game,
even
style
if you have to bring
gameplay,
a battery pack with you. I mean, it's one of those games that would actually benefit from
when
that.
When you say battery pack, I've got literally you with a massive rucksack filled with a battery that you've hooked up to your to Wii.
Just a car battery with a USB-C connection.
I Am Setsuna came out to Vita, didn't it?
I think it was originally meant to, and I think it did come out to Vita in Japan, but it never got a release over
here. Speaking of which, early reports are that through the Nintendo eShop that launched today, that you can actually access other stores just by having an account that's based in those regions.
Yeah, I think very similar to the PlayStation 4. Mm. So if you create an account for yourself on the American store, you can access it that way. I think the only caveat is currently you can't buy from there.
Right.
Ah.
I think so. Possibly free demos you might be able to get, but I think currently you can't buy from there. I haven't looked into it fully yet.
Has anyone attempted to change their DNS settings? Because that's how I got the WWE Network a year earlier.
Don't say anything. Maybe
that's
don't.
That's how I watch Hulu Plus.
Maybe don't let people know these things. Anyway.
I don't care. I'm paying them money.
I know. It's one of those weird grey areas, though, that I'm not sure is necessarily something.
Well, we should have Hulu Plus in the UK, and they should
stop
moaning.
That would be a thing. But look, I mean, for me, the one that I'd really want to pick up is Bomberman, but then I don't think you'll get the advantages out of that without having 8 controllers, and who wants to spend twice as much on the consoles as on controllers on day one? So,
not only that, but spending what is probably twice as much on the game as well. I don't think the game is worth what they're charging for it.
That's hell of
it.
It should be
quite a lot for a Bomberman title,
I think, and that'd be pushing out, and only because you could get a lot out of the sort of multiplayer content. It does apparently have single player, but still, come on.
I think I wouldn't mind the cost of the game if it was similar to what's the other game? Snipper Clips, I think it's called, which is another launch title, at least in the US.
That's one I'd definitely pick up.
That's the thing. I think you can get a version of that that comes with 2 extra Joy-Cons.
Ah, yes. I think you're right.
And if that's the case, I mean, that would be a really good deal for Bomberman, because obviously then you could do the 4-player kind of straight away. And at least that would alleviate some of the cost as well. Like, they could obviously increase the cost maybe to 60 to cover the controllers as well. But that would seem like a much fairer bargain. But at the moment, I don't think it's worth it currently.
Although, again, only early reports at the moment. But it does seem as though there are some issues with some of the Joy-Cons. Particularly with one, is it left Joy-Con being a bit of a poor man's Joy-Con, apparently, basically, in comparison with when in terms of syncing and you know.
I've heard the stories as well. People are able to disconnect it quite easily by either blocking it with their hand or possibly, like, if you have too much of a grip on it, it could actually lose connectivity to the Switch.
I haven't actually worked this out, but is left Joy-Con's the one that's in the better formation, isn't it? or like with the stick in quite
yes,
a way.
It's the one that doesn't have the stick right in the middle of the controller.
Exactly. So you either have the bad stick placement or you have the one that doesn't sync up very well. That's a bit of a lose-lose situation.
So it's kind of like when you have friends over and you have your controller and then you have the crappy third-party
yeah, exactly,
one.
Yeah.
It's like you have two third-party ones.
That's not great for Nintendo. But, I mean, look, again, not wanting to rain on anyone's parade. There you go, Coleman. Changed.
Better.
Changed there. Yeah, it's better, yeah?
What do you have against parades?
Anyway, yeah. But don't rain on anyone's parade. But, yeah, it's something... It feels weird for me to be detached from the kind of hype of console launches. I lied on Twitter earlier, gentlemen. I lied. And I only just worked it out a bit later. But I did say that the last time that I didn't buy a launch console was PS2, I think. No, what was it? Last time I didn't buy a launch console was something else. But I subsequently worked out that actually I didn't buy my Wii U at launch because Alex bought me it for the Christmas afterwards, basically.
I don't think I've ever bought a console at launch.
Really? Never?
No, never.
Well, I usually do. I'd love getting caught up in that hype and deciding what games you're going to get with it on launch day and stuff like that. And
even in the early days when the Mega Drive 2 came out, I had the Master System 2.
Well, I think the first one I ever remember actually buying at launch was the Dreamcast. And then, yeah.
I'm just thinking about it now because you're talking about it. I think the first console I actually bought at launch, excluding, like, the Vita, was the PS4.
Yeah?
Because I got the PS3 after it. The PS2 was a gift when I was younger, and that came after it as well. Yeah, I think the only one I bought at launch was the PS4.
Interesting.
I think the closest for me was the Xbox 360. Because I didn't buy it at launch, but I have bought a launch console. I bought a Wii on launch. And I had to go for a ridiculous rigmarole to get it.
You got caught up in the Wii shenanigans.
Well, no, because I had to go to a store that was like in a neighbouring town. Drive up to there.
Oh, you little people in the sticks, eh?
I had to go register my name in the store and then come back like 8 hours later. And they gave me an envelope, a golden envelope with a Triforce stamped onto it. And then I had to wait around till I could go and redeem my voucher inside this envelope. And then I could take away my Wii and Twilight Princess.
I think for my Wii U, a mate of mine had a mate who could get them through Tesco's or something like that. Anyway, but anyway.
Yeah, I think that's how I got the 360.
But yeah, as I said, it's weird to be detached from that kind of hype. And, you know, I can kind of see me possibly picking one of these up because of the like kind of dual nature of it being, you know, a useful thing for people in our positions with our type of lives where, you know, going out and working to a job but trying to do reviews to deadlines as well, being able to play it wherever you are is actually quite handy. But yeah, I mean, I don't know if this is me just being burnt from previous console generations of Nintendo, but I'm waiting for the hardware revision before I jump in, I think.
I'm quite happy to go for the console as it is. I just can't afford it right now.
Well, I probably would be stupid enough to buy one right now if I had the money, and that does play its part. But I think, yeah, for me, like, if I really, really wanted it, it doesn't matter how poor I was, I'd just go and get it. You know, I'm that type of stupid person. But yeah, like, I don't know, I'm not significantly motivated enough, and I do think that there's a strong possibility that we'll see a console revision and a price drop within the first year, or maybe even it might be the Christmas afterwards or something, but at some point we'll see that, and then that's probably the point where I'll jump on board.
Can we stop talking about the Nintendo Switch now?
Yes.
Let's switch topics.
Let's switch.
Cool. Tim, talk about Horizon Zero Dawn.
Horizon Zero Dawn, I'll mention fairly quickly because I've only played the opening...
Timpressions.
Timpressions. Yeah, I've played the first 4 or 5 hours, maybe 6 or so. Basically, for anyone that goes in, and I won't explain this much more, but for anyone that's played the game, I'm just about to go into the proving, basically. So that's all I'll say on that one. Basically, I'm really torn with kind of what to say and what not to say, because I don't want to spoil anything about the game. I will like align myself with anyone that you've seen say anything along the lines of this is an absolute masterclass in video game design, presentation, and, you know, the craft of making a video game in general. Like, it's just wonderfully well made. Like, we said from what we played as that early portion, and we've been saying since EGX, that demo didn't do it justice, and it really didn't. It doesn't take very long with the game to get quite, not just absorbed into the kind of the combat mechanics and what's going on with it, but just to be fully immersed in that world and be, like, emotionally connected with Aloy as a character, and just, I am so intrigued by, you know, the world that they've set up and everything that's going on. Like, it's a bit weird, though. Like, you can tell who either got a review copy or just buys digital games in some of the ways that some people have talked about it, because I swear I heard some people, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I swear I heard some people saying, you'll be quite surprised about, like, you know, how far in the future, like, you know, at what point in time in the future it is and stuff like that. And I'm like, it literally says that first words on the back of the box. It's 1,000 years in the future. So I hate to spoil that for anyone, but it's on the back of the box, first couple of words. But yeah, for anyone that doesn't know, it's 1,000 years in the future. Basically, man has kind of lost, control of the planet. We're no longer the primary kind of top of the food chain species type of thing. It's post-dystopian future, is that kind of a phrase that makes sense? It's kind of, yeah, things have fallen apart, and then we're catching up at the point in times where, like, humankind is living in tribes and, you know, nothing what they once were. You can get a hint of, at least early on, like, what the tribes people think of as what happened in history. Like, I urge anyone who's playing the game, there's a point in time where you get to listen to a children's story being told, or a story being told to children. I urge you to listen to that because it's quite interesting. It basically goes through that whole history and stuff.
Is it like the start of Moana?
I don't know. I haven't seen that yet.
Because that's exactly how Moana opens.
Right,
yes,
okay.
Exactly.
I watched Moana again last night.
Okay, it's not the opening of the game, but it's just a point in the game where you can take the choice to sit down and listen to that story. Listen to that story, it's very interesting. Anyway.
At any point, does the rock sing?
Yes.
Cool. I'm in.
There's no singing rocks in this. That's ridiculous, Coleman. Anyway. Right. Oh. Yeah, but basically, as I said, I'm trying deliberately not to say too much about some things because I just urge you to go and play it. It's like, for me, anyone that wants to prove that there is it's a good idea to go and set up a different universe and to stop the people that are currently making first-person shooters and free them to go and do other things. Activision, are you listening? But yeah, like, if there was ever a better argument for this, like, I you know, grew to love Killzone. Killzone 2, I think, was one of the best games of previous generation. Other people are arguing with me anyway. But I loved the series, and I was almost sad that they stopped doing it. I've forgotten about it almost now. Like, it's kind of Horizon Zero Dawn. I'm so glad you did this. It's a infinitely more interesting universe that they set up. And yeah, I urge everyone to kind of delve in and go discover it for yourself, because it's definitely worth doing. As a fan of video games, you definitely want to go do so. Also, as you type this, Coleman, there is no colon in Horizon Zero Dawn. Just so
is there not?
No.
I think we've had this discussion before as well.
Yeah, possibly. But there is no colon. There is no colon.
Is that DLC?
Yeah, the colon comes as DLC.
You get to see Aloy's colon.
Oh, God, no. But yeah, like, as I said, just, like, mechanically, it works really well and feels really good. And, I can already see kind of where it's heading in terms of, like, you know, some of the other creatures that I've kind of seen through other things as well, but they've kind of foreshadowed and stuff. And I'm so intrigued and so ready and on board and just want to dive into it and discover all the mysteries of, you know, the background to Aloy and what's going on in the kind of wider world and everything as well. And yeah, it's already laid out very well for me, and I'm looking forward to diving deeper.
I look forward to playing this at DMed's flat while I'm waiting for a Switch to arrive, because I'm watching, I want to say, Logan?
Yes.
Yeah, I know you too well.
Right, he's Coleman, and he went on an adventure and then got ill.
I went on an adventure and then I got nerd flu and then I couldn't be on the last show.
I know. So tell us about your adventure, Mr. Coleman. Where did you adventure?
I went back to the London Olympia, which is good. Down the road from me, so I like events happening there.
Yeah, we haven't been there for a month.
Yes. So I went to the PC Gamer Weekender, which I'd heard of the year before, and I did think about going, but I can't remember. I think I got stuck in work or something.
And we're not the biggest PC gamers, to be fair.
No, we're not, but I do like going to events. So yes, that is a thing that happened. So this happened over the 18th and 19th of February, again, at the Olympia in London. We gave a plug about it a couple of weeks ago as well, offered out tickets. And while I was there, I got to go do a couple of things. I got to check out our friend Ollie do the talk on Halo Wars 2. He was explaining the Blitz mode, and then that made me go, huh, I really want to play Halo Wars 2 now. I didn't think I really wanted to play Halo Wars 2.
Just as a small disclaimer, for those, Ollie is someone we're both friends with and has worked on that. And I have to say, I mentioned the Blitz mode a couple of months ago in the podcast, and I completely forgot the reason why I was so interested in Blitz mode. But I generally read an article on Blitz mode because I was like, oh yeah, I remember being something hearing about that, and then read the article and got really excited about Blitz mode and talked about it on the podcast, but actually forgot that that was the mode that Ollie was working on. So there you go. Just to fully explain myself and excuse myself.
I didn't know as well, because every time I've checked in with Ollie over the game, I've just, you know, it's in passing, just kind of gone, hey, how's the game going? Oh, it's going good. All right, cool, carry on. When I went to the show and I sat in on his talk, and rather than being engaged in a conversation where I could say sarky stuff about it, I had to sit and listen to him and watch a presentation. But yeah, I had a quick go on Halo Wars 2, which was already out at this point. Actually, I think at this point it was out for people who pre-ordered or pre-ordered a special version or something. But anyway, it's out now for everyone. And the reason the Blitz mode caught my attention is because it's the RTS for people who don't play RTS games.
Yeah. That sounds like a good thing.
Yeah, and it's got more of a card-based focus to it, which I'm also appeals to me. Yeah, I'm not a particular tabletop card game. That's more your realm, Tim. But simplifying the idea of an RTS, that's something that really interested me. And having a quick go on it was a lot easier to pick up.
Yeah.
I don't want to dwell too much on it because it is out at the moment. You can go play it for yourself. I want to talk about more about the games that are coming out. But yeah, I thought that was really interesting for someone who doesn't, you know, someone who's tried several different RTSs and just not got along with
them.
And
it takes the base building element out of it, which for me is the most kind of time management-y type annoying non-strategy type element of it that annoys me, basically. So as I said, yeah, I was interested in it from the sounds of it, but then yeah, realized, oh yeah, he's working on it. But anyway, so what else did you get to see?
I checked back in with Nature's Zombie Apocalypse.
Ooh, how's that shaping up?
Pretty much the same as the last time we played.
Right.
So we've spoken about it on the show before. We had the developers on the show before during our EGX special last year. This is a twin stick shooter. It's set in several different real world locations, but it's a zombie apocalypse and all humans in the world are zombies now. So you are the animal kingdom, several members of the animal kingdom, wielding weapons and taking down zombies. So I played the London level again.
That's the kind of train station type one, was it? Or
This was an open street this time.
Oh, right, okay.
So I'm assuming it's meant to be like Piccadilly Circus, Leicester Square type area. And I got to play as a gorilla with a Gatling gun.
Nice.
And I'm happy with that.
I mean, this does look silly fun. Does it still remain playably, stupidly fun, basically, yeah?
Yeah, it's exactly that.
Carnage. I mean,
it's a dumb, fun twin-stick shooter that can have up to four players playing co-op, and you can do local play as well. Actually, no, it's not up to four players. It's even more than four players.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Seems to remember like, loads of people playing at one time.
I think it's
right?
Eight player in total.
Something ridiculous.
I didn't get to, unlike at Rezzed and EGX, I didn't get to have a game with a full squad of people. It was just me, a developer, and a little kid that just turned up to play the game. So there was only three of us playing, and we sucked at it pretty bad. But it's still very enjoyable. It's still a pretty cool game. I'm looking forward to picking that one up when it comes out. I'm just trying to see if I can find if there's a... Oh, it's in early access.
Ah!
You can buy it right now.
Go get it right now.
Add that to my cart and good. Right. The other one I checked out, I'm actually really excited for this game now. It's called Dead Cells.
Right.
This is a 2D Castlevania.
Okay.
What do they call them? They call them Metroidvania.
Metroidvania.
I hate that term. It's a Metroid. It's a 2D Metroidvania Souls-like.
Okay.
Yeah, it's kind of a dungeon-crawling, randomized level, really
hence
hard
Dead
game.
Cells, I get it now. Right, yeah. Okay.
I really enjoy this game.
Yeah?
Yeah, it flows really well. It's hack-and-slash kind of combat, lots of rolling around because of the whole Dark Souls element, trying to avoid enemies as well as attack them.
Is it dead hard as well, Coleman?
It's very hard. And you can only hold two weapon items at a time. So you can right. hold a sword and a shield, or you can hold a sword and a bow, or a bow and a shield. And
can you go dual wielding on the bows? Can you do that?
No, you can't.
Oh.
That would be silly.
Well, it would.
How would you pull... Okay.
Dual wield, like, crossbow, but not two bows.
Okay.
You'd have to use your toes or something to pull the string.
Or your teeth.
The string. Sorry. But anyway, yes, yeah, sorry. Tim derailing me on that. There's really interesting things about it as well. I mean, there's a whole upgrade system. You go out and find new weapons in loot crates and stuff, and the treasure chests. And there was a point where I came into a room and there was a giant treasure chest. I was like, oh, cool, giant treasure chest. And the developer ran up behind me. He's going, no. And I'd already hit it at that point. And it was like a cursed treasure chest.
Ah.
So it opens up and it's like big teeth on the mouth, and it just like grabs hold of your arm and starts biting down, and blood splurts out.
Ah.
And you still get your treasure. You get like your cool sword or whatever, but you'll get a curse.
So
my curse was I then had to kill 10 enemies in a row, and if one of them hit me even once, I died. So it adds parameters like that to the game as well. So the second time I was playing through, I'd get to a cursed chest and go, yeah, I'm not falling for that this time.
Did it steal anything else from the kind of Souls series? Like, does it have a mechanic where you've got to get back to where you were or anything, or not so
well, much? Well, Jim, as a man who's never played the Souls games...
Okay, when you died, did you have to get back to the place where you died from to get some of the things you'd achieved in those runs?
That might be a feature in the full game. I'm right. not 100%. Like, what I played was just a limited demo.
Yeah.
So
okay.
If I died, it literally just took me back to the start of the game. But yeah, I really enjoyed it, and I found it... Even though there wasn't, because I went on the Sunday, so there wasn't a lot of people at the event, which was really nice. A nice change of pace for a game.
I prefer pace of change.
Anyway, I really enjoyed this. It comes out some point in spring this year, so again, that's going to be a day one purchase for me. I'm really looking forward to it.
Based on what you've said regarding Dead Cells, it sounds very similar to a game called Salt and Sanctuary. And if that is a kind of a game that you like, then you might want to give that a try. I think it's on PS4 now, and it's definitely on PC. I don't know what other platforms it's on. But you might want to give that a try. It sounds similar. Not quite the same random level generation thing, but yeah, it sounds very similar to what you're talking about.
I've heard of it. I haven't tried it. But that's not got does that have the castle, the Metroidvania style down as well?
I think it's far more Souls-like, so I don't think it has the same thing. I think there are shortcuts that you unlock.
Right.
But I don't think it has the same Metroidvania where you pick up something and suddenly you're able to go into all these other areas that you previously weren't. I think it's more one massive map and then you can kind of unlock shortcuts here and there. Very similar to Souls.
This one, Dead Cells, is from what I'm looking at, because I've seen screenshots probably... Because Salt Sanctuary, it's very kind of gloomy, shadowy type style to the game. This one's very, it's pixelated, it's gorgeous pixel art to it, and very neon, very bright, lots of different environments as well. So that's something else that really attracts me. Like, you show me a gorgeous looking pixelated game, and I'm going to fall in love with it. Simple as that.
You're a sucker for a pixelated game, eh, Coleman?
Yes. But spring 2017, so keep an eye out for that one. I think that was a Greenlight project originally as well. So I don't know if that's going to go early access in spring or full release, but I'm definitely going to have to grab me some of that. I played from the creators of Hohokam and Super Exploding Zoo, which are two games I tolerated Hohokam, I've got to admit. I enjoyed Super Exploding Zoo. God, I bought Hohokam day one and got really annoyed when I took it, when I was like, oh, this is it. Okay.
Yeah,
this is not
Hohokam was like... I can see the kind of relaxing zenness to it, but I can't see enough game for my interest.
I've spoken about the game I like to put on and just kind of lose myself in and forget.
But
about
Super Exploding Zoo was silly and fun, and yeah, I liked that game.
It was, yeah, but didn't play enough, was just it was too much nothing for me.
Yeah,
that's what it felt like.
A bit too zen for your liking, hey?
Yes. So, Frostbisher was the other game they made. I'd never tried that one, so I don't
know. Okay.
But it's by those guys, and it's called Loot Rascals.
Right.
And this is a really weird game, kind of cartoony 2D, again, is that seems to be their style that they go for.
Yeah.
And you're a spaceman that's called to a
planet. Spaceman.
I think you're called to a planet to find a machine that's gone missing. And,
as you do.
Yeah, and you have to kind of wander around a sort of tabletop-style map and avoid monsters and battle weak monsters at the right time and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And I'm trying to remember the... I haven't really been able to connect it to anything because it's not a type of game that I would have ordinarily played. I just played because it was at the expo. But what I really liked about it was the style of animation and the kind of comedy to it. Like, all the
looks
voiceovers
very weird,
in the game,
doesn't it? Kind of thing.
It is very weird. All the voiceovers in the game, they seem to be... You've got an AI character that is your companion friend, and he seems to be played by a very disinterested Scottish guy. And, like, they stutter and they make mistakes in the way they talk, but it's there written in the subtitles as well, so you know it's intentional. And it's... I just found it really interesting, and I don't fully know what I was doing in the game, but I really enjoyed it, and I want to play more of it so I can figure it out.
Yeah, there seems to be some mechanic around things getting stolen by AI players and then dropping in other, like, human player games.
Yeah.
And stuff. That sounds weird. But anyway, yeah, sounds interesting. Anyway.
It was really interesting. That's coming out some point early 2017, but we haven't got a full release date for that yet. And I got loads of stickers for it as well. I like stickers. They go on my laptop.
Stickers help you remember a game for a long time as well.
Well, they don't, because I made notes on everything I played, and I was like, what the hell was that game with all the cartoons and the Scottish accent? I don't remember. And I literally had to look up, like, cartoony map game, Scottish accents. I just tried everything I could till I could find the title for it. So there you go. And again, I've forgotten what it is already.
Loot Rascals. It's another one.
Loot Rascals.
It's kind of two generic words stuck together to make something sound a bit generic. I mean, yeah, it looks like an interesting prospect, and I can kind of see why they went with that title.
Knights and Bikes. This one's been pretty well known for a little while now. It had a Kickstarter last year. It was very successful.
Which I backed.
Oh, nice.
Oh,
one.
Yeah.
So this is by a company called Foam Sword. They are, I believe they're headed up by an ex-Media Molecule dev.
Yes, which is primarily the reason I went after the game and supported it, because pretty much anything they do, I'm good to go with, you know?
So this is kind of a co-op and single-player adventure game, I guess is the right term for it. It's very story-based RPG sort of thing. Everything's done in a hand-drawn animated style, and everything is beautiful, and it looks like everything looks like it's kind of cut out of paper. Kind of like
Tearaway or something.
Tearaway, but 2D instead.
Right.
The style is very Tearaway, but 2D.
Yeah.
I got kind of Earthbound feel from it as well. I played it with Lauren. It had a two-player mode, so we played together. And we were just two characters on their bikes, and we were out to rescue a librarian, I believe. Was the...
Okay.
Yeah, we didn't really get much context to what we were doing or why we were doing. I guess they were really depending on people to have read
the
Kickstarter.
Do you need a reason to rescue a librarian, Coleman? If a librarian is in trouble, don't you just, you know, automatically...
Yeah,
that's the type of thing
I guess
do.
So.
All heroes wear capes.
And we went through this area and had to go through a food court and battle weird creatures. And then we got to a souvenir shop and they had foam swords. And the foam swords came to life and we had to fight those. And then we had to fight monsters and foam swords to rescue the librarian. I don't know what happened, Tim.
It almost sounds like it's in the imagination of the kids from South Park or something kind of thing going on.
Sort of, yeah, but nothing crude about it whatsoever.
Yeah, but clean, suitable for work edition.
But I really enjoyed the style of the game more than anything. I didn't really understand what was happening that much in the game itself, but I really want to try more of it and I want to figure this stuff out. It kind of reminded me, I was surprised to see it didn't have the name Double Fine attached to it, because that's what it looked like. It looked like a Double Fine project, like a costume quest
type thing. On there.
Yeah, something like that. But yeah, keep an eye out for that. Knights and Bikes. Mm. And then the last one was Portal Outside Influence.
Now this one I'm really interested to hear about.
Okay.
Because I think I've heard bits already, but anyway.
Yes. Portal Outside Influence. The studio name is Elite Treacle, and the developer's name is Sam Morris.
Good.
Who's an ex-sarcastic gamer listener, he told me.
Really? Okay.
He went, I turned out, I was like, hey, this guy likes sarcastic gamer. I was like, what? No, wait, we're Big Red Barrel. He's like, yeah, I used to listen to The Blue Show. Like, we had a nice little natter about sarcastic gamer and stuff. So that was pretty cool. So yeah, check us out. this guy's a student and he's been working on, like, he made this fan mod of Portal called Outside Influence.
Mm-hmm.
And it ended up getting picked up by Valve. They let him use the license. They're going to let him use, like, all the, you know, the GLaDOS voice and all this kind of stuff.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, and I can't remember who's publishing it. I think someone told me Sega, but I don't believe that's right.
Anyway,
it's really interesting. The idea is you're an outsider who's come across the compound.
Right.
And you've ended up falling in, you know, you've got stuck in the compound for whatever reason, and now you're trying to get out. And there's someone talking to you through a communication device, kind of being like the Andrew Ryan of the whole thing, guiding you through the levels. Right. And he keeps leading you into tests. And at the very start of this game, they're like, it better not be another bloody test. It's like, no, I'm sure it's fine. Oh, no, it's a test. it kind of went on like that. And the whole premise of this one is you can only fire, I think it's the blue portal. And the orange portal is generated through something else, like a machine. And you'll have one stationary portal, but now you have the ability to fire portals through portals.
Yeah. That so just sounds look, mental.
Yeah, so you look through the orange portal and then have to fire the blue portal somewhere else. And and because you're looking through the portal that you're meant to go through to the next one, it really screws up your eyes that all of a sudden things change in front of you.
I swear, like, it sounds like the puzzles that most broke your brain in Portal made into a whole game.
Yeah.
Basically.
Pretty much.
Sounds awesome.
Like someone's done a, why can't we fire portals through portals? Okay, I'm going to turn that into a game. Okay, yeah. Valve like it, and they're going to turn it into a game.
it's a really cool story, just for that type of things as well. But yeah, I don't know. Like, is it basically just Portal remixed a bit? Like, how did it play?
It played like Portal, but with some, you know, some new features and some limitations from the previous game. So you had not having the ability to just fire blue and orange portals at will definitely limits to what you can do.
Okay.
But it was interesting. I mean, like, it's in very early stages at the moment from what he showed me. I mean, like, this is how early it was. The thing started up. It goes, okay, there's meant to be a video playing on a screen behind you. Do you see the video? And I turned around and went, no. And God damn it. Why is it not showing? You know, that sort of thing. You just kept pulling up, like, dev mode, going through the debug menu and sorting different things out.
See, you always
out.
Get, like, I don't know about you, but I've seen games in that position a few times. You get devs being really really apologetic and overly apologetic. Like, oh, I'm so sorry. And I don't know about you, but I want to, like, almost kind of just, you know, sitting there going, look, it's fine. This is actually possibly more fascinating than half of the game I was playing just then. You know what I mean? Like, I like seeing this side of things. Show me more.
Yeah.
Like, anyway.
That's the cool thing about indies at these types of events, because, like, you line up for, you know, the latest Call of Duty game or Battlefield or whatever.
Yeah.
And then you'll go play it. And if it crashes, they go, all right. And these aren't developers. These are just the guys that are helping out. And they're like, all right, wait, we'll put you on again. All right, that's fine. If you do have an indie developer, they're like, oh, do you know what? I've seen this bug happen before. Or, oh, I haven't seen this one. Yeah. Oh, great. You've really helped me out. And they're like, they'll write down what the bug is and all this kind of stuff. Like, it's really interesting to see that side of it. I've never seen someone openly swear.
And then you turn around and go, and when am I getting my testing check?
Give me a job. But it's going to have the voice actors from, well, you know, the voice actor playing GLaDOS in there. I'm really hoping Wheatley's in there in some capacity, because I love Wheatley. But at the moment, it just had, I think he was playing the GLaDOS role, because he said he had a friend she was meant to do the role, and then came down sick on the day of recording, so he just had to do it himself. Put on a slightly feminine voice and do it that way. And then the really interesting bit is at the very end, because I got stuck at a point. I went, dude, I got to stop playing. Like, Lauren stopped playing because it spun her out a bit because she was getting messed up by the portal views. So I had to stop because I was literally getting angry. because I get kind of subconscious about it as well. I can play Portal at home. I can make mistakes. I can look up a guide or something if I need to. If I'm sat at an event and the developer's watching me play, I get
really
subconscious.
Yeah, there's some pressure that comes with it.
And like, there was a dude waiting behind me. He's like, oh, you're back. He goes, yeah, I'm going to speedrun it. I'm like, oh, and I suck so bad. I don't need this right now. That's when, hey, man, I think I've played enough. He's like, yeah. I go, you're getting angry with it. I go, yeah, I got stuck.
But see, were you put in the position of this whole event that you had to WASD at any point as well? I don't WASD well, and I've like, I'm never going to do that to a developer again. I'm like, I don't make me do this to your game. You'll hate. You'll dislike me. I'll dislike the keyboard, and it'll all go horribly wrong.
I think I got a controller for Nature's Zombie Apocalypse and Knights and Bikes, and the rest I had to play on keyboard and mouse. But the very end that really interested me was because it comes to kind of like a black screen, and then someone's just talking to you. And I think Lauren understands more about the ending than I do, because I just got really thrown off because it's Jim Sterling.
Yeah,
Jim Sterling doing a voiceover at the end. I was like, ah, Jim Sterling in a Portal game. That's weird.
Yeah, that would be odd. But yeah, one thing I wanted to ask, actually, I forgot. Was this more based on the original Portal or Portal 2, or just a kind of combination of the two?
I believe, from what the guy was saying, this is set in between Portal and Portal 2.
Ah, that would make sense. Okay,
so cool. I'm believing at this point, I forgot her name. The Shell? Sill? Cell? Something like that. Whatever the main character's name is, at this point she's in stasis in between the two games, is the idea.
But yeah, I mean, another chance to go revisit Portal. I might just go and play Portal 2 again. I'd love that game, and I haven't played it
yet. I do love Portal, and it's on backwards compatibility.
Oh, that's a good shout. But yeah, just also in general, what else was there to see and do at the PC Gamer Weekender? And, you know, was it a good show from what you saw in general?
Yes. So Sega were running live streams of some kind of campaign they were doing. I didn't really understand it. But I left. I stood in the background of their stream several times and waved to the camera. There was tournaments going on for various different shooters, and I think there was some for Halo Wars and stuff as well. You know, when we went to play Tekken 7 at EGX, and we just kind of played it on a computer, you know, a regular PlayStation or whatever.
Yep.
They had like a proper arcade two-player cabinet set up to run through Tekken 7 together. They had loads of different VR setups on display. You had to kind of get in early for those and register and get your name down. Like, Lauren really wanted to play this game called, I think it's called This American Life.
Mm.
That sounds like it might be right. Or The American Dream or something. And the whole idea is you've got to live the American dream. You've got to have the 2.5 children and the nuclear job and all this kind of stuff. However, your hands are made of guns. And I really like that idea. So that's a VR game, apparently. I'm going to check that out.
But wasn't there some VR stuff that was being charged for separately? Was that Lauren that said
VR
that maybe?
One VR was charged up separately. I think Lauren said it was run by Game, but I don't think it was. It was next to the game store. I think she might have mistaken.
Okay.
But they had this whole experience where, so you wear the VR backpack, so you've got a PC on your back, basically. And they're very streamlined now. They look really cool.
Yeah, they look good.
So you can wirelessly move around with the VR pretty seamlessly. But also, you go in a sealed unit, and all the floors vibrate, and it's got all these different things that happen, like they pump air in and stuff. And so it's more like the 4D experience mixed with the VR experience.
Right.
Yeah. But that, I think that was the only thing that charged out of the games, and that was £5 ago.
I think I heard they had tabletop section there as well, no?
They did. Isdevium were there.
Oh, our friends from Isdevium.
Yes. In fact, the woman who was being the instructor on the games, I remember her specifically because she was very chatty at one of the res, and I gave her like a 15% discount. I was quite happy to see a familiar face. So yeah, they had board games on sale there. Game had a setup, so you could go in and look at the small selection of game PC games, and then their vast array of Funko Pops. That's what Game is now. I don't get into a game lately. It's Lego Dimensions and Funko Pops. Loads of stalls, loads of VR tournaments. It was really cool. I looked at last year's one and thought, I might give that a try. Didn't really have the time for it. I'm hoping they keep it at the Olympia again because it's a really good venue, and London needs more PC game. Needs more game events in general. And I was dubious on going to a PC gamer event because I'm not a PC. I play some games on PC, but I'm more a console boy myself. But I really enjoyed it. And as well, it wasn't as packed out as other events. I heard it was quite hectic on the Saturday, but I went on the Sunday because I've learned now. And it really paid off for doing that. I could kind of go around at my own leisure. Like, I tried in with Sonic Mania again. A game that I spent an hour and a half queuing up for and then beat the demo in 30 seconds and got really angry about that.
Have you never been to a Sonic game before? I'm sorry. Like, what?
Yeah. And the annoying thing is I queued up again to play the second level as well. But this time I could literally just walk up at my own leisure, pop on a pair of headphones and then play. And then they gave me some codes at the end for games, which I'll have to remember to give out at some point.
Okay.
Yeah, I could just go up, I'll go, right, I'll just play the next game because no one's waiting to play this game.
Nice. It's yeah, it's always good. It's always nice. When
it was so nice. It was such a nice breath of fresh air. And I think I inhaled too much of the fresh air and then I got sick.
Then you got the nerd flu.
I got the nerd flu, man. No, it is really recommended by me, totally.
Definitely no. Like, don't go around recommending the nerd flu, Coleman. That's a bad thing.
The game of weekend, though. When that comes in 2018, they should push for more of these events. Like, two events a year, not one event. They should be like the new PAX. PAX UK. They'll go all over the UK doing PC Gamer Weekender.
Or PC Gamer Weekender, now including consoles. That'll get me there. But anyway.
Oh, yeah, that'll do it. But, yeah, I think you should join me next year, Tim. Because I'm definitely going to get next year.
It's always nice, as you say, to the events where you can actually speak to the developers and stuff as well. It's always good.
And it's nice bumping into people you know. Without having to go to Birmingham. Birmingham's lovely. It's just too far.
Yeah. It's not here.
Dear Ed, you didn't have any games written down on the agenda.
No, yeah, for me, I've basically gotten about an hour into Horizon Zero Dawn. I have not played enough of it to make any kind of judgments on it.
Mm. Have you figured out how far in the future it is set?
I believe it's 1,000 years, but I got the digital copy, so I don't know for certain. But I played the first hour, and similar to Tim, I like what they're doing so far with the world building. I mean, it's just started, but it's really kind of cool, actually. And I'm really happy for Guerrilla because I've always liked their games, even if, you know, they weren't the best story-wise. I thought technically they were fantastic. Now they seem to have finally been able to marry a kind of a technical genius with a really good storytelling kind of bit behind it, so I'm really happy for them. I'm hoping that the rest of the game is as good as the start of it is.
I'm surprised you haven't got deeper into it, considering that there's a still, I mean, it might be down to Amazon and we could get a live update on the situation, but
I have the page open.
Yeah, at the moment, as it stands, you could possibly be getting a new console with Zelda tomorrow.
Yes.
And You haven't completed Horizon yet? How are you going to handle it? Like, that's two big open world games you've got to play once.
Did you get a physical copy or a digital copy of Horizon?
Digital.
Ah, that's a pain in the ass.
Guess who wanted to borrow your copy?
Zelda. Can I borrow Horizon Zero Dawn?
Sure.
Can we do remote play?
Yes, no problem.
Excellent. No problem.
Yeah, I got a digital copy, and to be honest with you, based on everything that it's saying on this Amazon page, I think tomorrow at least is going to be an entirely Horizon day. I'm weeping.
Oh, I hear it's one of the game I hear it's a potential contender for Game of the Year, so don't moan too much. It's a good game.
Yeah, I'm not going to be too upset about it, I'll be honest.
Cool.
But yeah, it's like two massive open world, really high quality games dropping in the same week. It's not something I can really complain about, I'll be honest.
Yeah, but the only other thing that I'll mention on that tack just before we kind of get out of here as well is don't be too put off by the open world moniker as well. Because basically, I wrote an article not that long ago saying basically that I had my fill of open world games and I wanted a more linear experience. This still feels like a well-focused and directed experience. I'm possibly in the early portion of the game, so it might be a bit more so. But there's kind of, you know, it opens out into areas, but it still feels like the story is well handled and well directed. And don't let the fact that you might have been put off by similar open world games, don't let that put you off trying this, because it's definitely worth going into. So yeah,
I was gonna drop a Great British Debate on us today, but I think we've run out of time, to be honest.
Okay,
which is a pity because I had a corker today.
You had a corker of what?
I had a corker of a Great British Debate.
Oh, and we're gonna have to drop it.
Yeah,
I tell you what though, we had the discussion earlier in the show, and if other people want to join in the discussion on the forums this week, just let us know what the first console was that you bought at launch.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Yeah. We haven't really discussed that on the forums before. Be interested to see what stage people jumped in on, and what console was the first one they bought at launch. And bought at launch with your own money, not one that your parents bought for you at some point.
That's it. Yeah.
Because that's just cheating.
Yeah. That doesn't count.
I mentioned the Wii U earlier as like my first console at launch, my only console at launch, but the PlayStation 2. No, actually, no. The I think the Nintendo 64 was probably the first console I bought with my own actual money.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
And I'd saved up because I'd get like £10 a week, and I saved up for the N64 that I couldn't afford any games. So I just had this massive lump of plastic that I couldn't play anything on.
Oh, but the games were pretty expensive back then.
Yeah, I think a mate lent me a Turok for my first month. I played the hell out of Turok.
I love Turok. I just remember any time anyone mentions that game, the instant memory is of me and my friend playing it for the first time and taking an age and getting really scared in the first set of like bushes that we came across. And the only thing that ran out was like a chicken or something. It was something like really like, you know, and we were f***ing ourselves over this thing. And anyway, but yeah.
Did you constantly have to rub your CRT going, there must be condensation on this. There's a lot of fog going.
I remember playing Turok 2 with my friends a lot. Because that was the one that had the multiplayer on, the battle mode kind of thing. And we'd play that, and we'd have to pick either old Turok or new Turok, because either one of them would say, I am Turok. And they'd go, yes, you are! And that was about it. that was the only entertainment I had of the game. Anyway, Turok 2 is on PC this week, so enjoy. On GOG, Steam, and the other one. I forgot what the other one was.
For all your cutting-edge gaming news.
It got re-released. Anyway, talking about cutting edge news on games, Tim.
Yes,
talk
that's
to
me.
Us about the Tabletop Tuesday.
Well, yep, this Tuesday is a Tuesday, and every Tuesday we have a Tabletop Tuesday. And this Tuesday, the feature game is a game called Realm of Wonder. And for anyone that doesn't know, each week we give away a different game. All you have to do to possibly win yourself a copy is to come along and play the feature game the night it's the feature game. And yeah, this one looks like good fun. 2 to 6 people. It's got like kind of a spinny board kind of thing, like the like sort of rotating rings in the board that rotate like the map and stuff that you're playing on. And yeah, it's like a kind of combat sort of dice rolling kind of area management type game, basically. But yeah, like, it looks interesting, looks good fun. Come along and possibly win yourself a copy on the night as well. All good. Anyone that wasn't aware already, I was ill last week. I have been ill all week since actually doing last week's podcast. Hopefully we should be well enough to return for next week's show, next week's event. But yeah, for anyone that hasn't been along, come along. It's a good night. Great way to get introduced to games and possibly win yourself one while you're there too.
Cool. So that's Tabletop Tuesday on the 7th of March. Tolston, Landon, Loading Bar.
Yarp.
Yes. Cool. And we've got to say thank you to a few people, which I realised, 5 minutes ago that I hadn't written down at all. So I have no idea if anyone left us an iTunes review. If you did, thank you. If you haven't, why haven't you left us an iTunes review?
Why haven't you left us an iTunes review? We don't ask very much. God.
But I'm going to give the... Because I have heard the excuse for... I don't use iTunes. I can't use iTunes. iTunes is horrible. You know, all that kind of stuff.
Yep.
If you can't leave an iTunes review, I give you the task of going out and telling your friends or your family or whoever you think's going to enjoy this show, recommending this show to at least one friend, one person.
Grandpa, are you still using iTunes?
Ah!
Can you leave a review?
Ah! They're taking our jobs. The granddad, no. Build a wall. Shut up. That's a little look into my granddad's personal life there. And on the forums, Tim.
I was going to say I wasn't on the forum, but I was this week. Anyway, right, but yeah. We'd like to thank Mr. Ridcully's Hat and Richard Kirk, who I think possibly said nice things about me hosting the show last week. I thought it was going to be a bit of a be careful what you wish for, but people didn't seem to be as disgusted as I thought they might be.
Yes. I think I got one message.
Every cloud has a silver lining.
I required more messages of get well soon. I didn't get enough.
Yes. Well, you did, and you have. So
that nerd flu, that would have killed a lesser man. You don't know what I went through. Even Batman gets sick sometimes.
Yeah, I've got work flu, which is even worse.
On Twitter, thanks to Sad Wizard, and Rob Evans wants to know if Horizon Zero Dawn is worth getting.
Yeah, well, he asked that, but yeah, didn't he? I think he just commented on the fact that he just played the first level of For Honor and was definitely on board with that, basically. If you hadn't already guessed from what I was saying in the show, basically, if you're a fan of video games, you want to buy this video game. It's that simple for me, basically. Like, you need to see this as a game, basically. as I said, masterclass in storytelling, framing, setup, like mechanics, everything. It's worth seeing. Just yeah.
See, I set you up for like a long silence, and then a no. But hey, whatever. Fine.
Okay.
And on Facebook, DMed, you can read this one out.
No problem. That is on Facebook. We have Bumble Snuff Crimpy Snitch. Thank you, Bumble Snuff Crimpy Snitch.
I believe he had to change his name because Facebook said his name wasn't whatever the previous one, like Benedict Cumblebum or whatever.
I believe he plays Sherlock Holmes. I think you're confusing him.
Cool. That is everything. I think we've stretched this podcast out as long as it will possibly go. So for episode 233 of the Big Red Barrel UK podcast, I have been Coleman.
I might have been Tim, maybe.
I've definitely been Diarmuid.
Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, dear listeners, beware of the Nintendo Switch game shortage, because all the journalists are bloody eating the cartridges.
Yeah, no, come on. Oh, I can't believe we didn't talk about that.
I forgot.
Yeah, apparently they taste weird, but who the hell tasted them? That's like, who the hell discovered that we could drink cow milk? Like, who did that to a cow first?
Who went out into a field, got underneath a cow, and just said, let's see what happens now.
Yeah, exactly.
I was going to leave it as a stupid, dumb little throwaway thing before we go out, but I'm going to say, right, okay.
Yeah.
Video Gamer. I believe it was videogamer.com. They went, okay, we heard that these things are coated in something to stop kids sticking them in their mouths. Right, let's taste it, see if they're true. Can confirm. Disgusting. That's funny. We'll write a little throwaway feature about it.
And now everyone's tasting them.
But they did a stupid little thing, and it was on Twitter. And I was like, ah, that's kind of funny. Okay. And then the next thing I see, Kotaku is there. And they've got a whole feature on how they taste bad. And then Destructoid are doing it. And then people are talking about it on podcasts and stuff. And then today IGN are doing it, because they're late to the party sometimes. IGN are doing it. I don't need a full article on why cartridges taste bad.
I need to go onto the Big Red Barrel website and delete my editorial.
Oh, man,
stop
they
eating
taste
cartridges
bad.
Or Clearman's going to have nothing to play. That's why his Switch is delayed.
So many people have eaten copies of Zelda.
I have nothing to play it on.
Someone at Kotaku's got his bloody Joy-Con in their mouth. Where was I? Oh yeah. And until next time, dear listeners, goodbye.
And your ears are quite welcome for the podcasting goodness that you just heard. Why not roll on over to BigRedBarrel.com for more podcasts, news, reviews, and videos from the biggest, reddest site on the internet, BigRedBarrel.com.